I have the pleasure to welcome for the lecture of tonight, of this evening, Professor Carocci from the University of Catania, Italy. Caterina, I would like to speak in Greek so everybody will understand
yes.
The presentation of your CV. Λοιπόν, θα μιλήσω ελληνικά. Η κυρία Καρότση είναι τακτική καθηγήτρια στο Πανεπιστήμιο της Κατάνια και συγκεκριμένα στο τμήμα στην αρχιτεκτονική σχολή. Είναι μαζί η σχολή των πολιτικών μηχανικών και των αρχιτεκτών σε μια κατά κάποιο τρόπο πολυτεχνική σχολή. Η ίδια διδάσκει στο τμήμα αρχιτεκτώνων που εδρεύει στις Σιρακούσες. Η κυρία Καρότση λοιπόν είναι τακτική καθηγήτρια, έχει εξειδίκευση και διδακτορικό στην ιστορία της επιστήμης και των τεχνικών της κατασκευής και έχει δραστηριοποιηθεί έντονα στον τομέα της αποκατάστασης. Έχει πραγματοποιήσει πολλές αποκαταστάσεις και ειδικότερα έχει ασχοληθεί με την αξιολόγηση και το μετριασμό των αστικών και εδαφικών κινδύνων, σύμφωνα με το βιογραφικό της. Εξού και η απόψινη θεματολογία της διάλεξής της. Αύριο προβλέπεται μια παρουσίαση για την γνωστή πόλη της Ματέρα. Απόψε όμως, κεντρικό θέμα στη διάλεξή της θα είναι οι σεισμοί της Άκουιλα και το πώς στη συνέχεια διαχειρίστηκαν τον αστικό ιστό που είχε πάθει όλες αυτές τις ζημιές. Η κυρία Καρότση λοιπόν έχει μεγάλη εμπειρία στο συγκεκριμένο θέμα, στην διαχείριση ιστορικών κέντρων τα οποία έχουν υποφέρει από σεισμούς. Επίσης έχει συντονίσει πολλά ερευνητικά προγράμματα, είτε εθνικά είτε διεθνή, και έχει συμμετάσχει στην εκπόνηση διαχειριστικών σχεδίων, όχι μόνο για ό,τι θα μας μιλήσει απόψε, αλλά και για πολλές άλλες περιπτώσεις. Νομίζω ότι θα πρέπει να της δώσω το λόγο για να έχει άφθονο χρόνο να αναπτύξει το θέμα της. So, Κατερίνα, I think I want to add something more. I want to leave you ample time for your lecture. So please, if you like, to share your screen with us.
Yes, yes, yes.
Παρακαλώ να κλείσουν όλα τα υπόλοιπα μικρόφωνα. Παρακαλώ να κλείσουν όλα τα υπόλοιπα μικρόφωνα.
Can you see the screen, my screen? Yes, okay. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure for me to be here. The only pity is that we cannot be in the same room, of course. But I hope that it will be in another time. The title of my presentation is just the issue of my research along all my years of as a researcher. And you know very well that in Italy we have this problem of earthquake, like in Greece. And starting from the Umbria Marche earthquake in 1997, I was involved in every big earthquake that occurred in Italy, and above all in the last three that are L'Aquila 2009, Emilia, 2012, and Amatrice 2016. Of course, it's a lot of work I did on this, but in Italy there are many researchers involved in this field, both engineers and architects. The presence of the architects is due of the the attention that in Italy we have for the conservation, all not only for the monument, but also for the settlements. The safety and preservation of historical center is just my topics. So I decided to show you some experience I had in after this earthquake, because and selected just the work we did on two little settlements close to L'Aquila. This map is a fresco that you can see in the Galleria delle Carte Geografiche in Vaticano, in Rome. And you can see L'Aquila, the city, the river Raterno, and all the little settlements that are spread in this beautiful territory. As you know, this earthquake was very, very big, very important, and a lot of buildings, municipalities, and historical settlements were involved. Sorry. Okay, I was the leader of a group, a university group that was working immediately in the phase of emergency. And in that time, in 2009, we work first of all in the historical center of L'Aquila. We were spread to survey the damage situation both for monumental buildings and residential one. Then in the summer we moved in two little centers not far from L'Aquila, 15 kilometers from L'Aquila, Casentino and Fossa. In this time we worked as volunteers, and then we were involved in real project of restoration in Palazzo Ardinghelli first, and then for the Church of San Pietro di Coppito, that is one of the four main church in the historical center of L'Aquila. Some years later, we had the occasion to work on the post-earthquake reconstruction plan, both for Fossa and Villa Sant'Angelo. So the amount of work is very, very big, and I only show some of this work. Of course, I was not alone. I had two groups coordinated, and they were formed by young people that were doing this work for the first time. So it was a very interesting experience on this side. In Palazzo Ardinghelli, we experimented also the selection of the pieces of stones that collapsed in the loggia. And then we participated to the elaboration of the restoration project. Here I just put some picture above of the damage condition just the month after the earthquake, the front facade and the inner court, and down the today's condition. Only in 2019, the palace was reopening as contemporary art museum. For the church also, we worked a lot on the field to understand the causes of this very big damage that the church suffered, and also the Foria asked as consultant for the elaboration of the restoration project. Also in this case, only last summer, the restoration site was closed. So as you can see, this work are very, very long, and they are very difficult, not only for technical issue, but also for administrative funding and so on. As you, I think that you know very well this kind of problem. But I want to come to the focus of my presentation, that is to tell you how we worked on the urban fabric, on these little settlements that were damaged. A lot of settlements were damaged very, very hard, but sometimes in different way. So in the first time in the emergency period, we started to work in order to fit a procedure to collect data and in order to give to the municipality some advice to start with the action for the recovery. In Casentino, we worked in 2009, and we had different on-field survey in two moments. And first of all, the topic was the observation of damage in all the urban textile. Damages were very spread and severe, but not very much complete collapse appeared. The difficult of this work was, first of all, because we didn't have any map, any information, because the municipal palace collapsed. So no information and no data were available. The work proceed. We decided to work not on the unit, but on the block, because we saw immediately that a lot of damages were due to the position, the position of the unit each other, and so we tried to find this measure of survey. Of course, while studying the blocks, we pay particular attention to the construction techniques and above all to the presence of the anti-seismic devices placed in order to avoid external walls overturning. Because we saw in L'Aquila Center and also in other settlements of the area, that all these masonry techniques was composed with this tie rod, wooden tie rod, infilled in the stone masonry that were used like chains. So for this reason, we saw a lot of damage, but not so many overturning of the facade. After some years, when we collected and controlled, checked the data collected during the on-field work, we understood that this technique was took place after a big earthquake that struck L'Aquila in 1702. In fact, if you look at this facade that is placed in a square of a historical center of L'Aquila, you see that this big palace is almost entire. You can see just some cracks, sheer cracks, but not a sign of overturning of the facade. And this is very strange. Because the earthquake was very strong. But if you see with attention, you can see, I put all these red circles, you can see a lot of little chains put to maintain the facade. And these are, on the facade you can see these little metallic chains, but in the inner part there are wooden plates in the orthogonal wall. And also at the level of the top of the wall, at the level of the roof, there are a lot of constraints. In fact, the roof, the structure of the roof is also used to connect the upper part of the wall. So it's a technique clearly dedicated to prevent the overturning of the wall. Coming back to Casentino. At the end of
Paragallo, clista il microfono.
At the end of this work on the field, we had a lot of data, of course, that we could try to give some first preliminary indication. In fact, for example, we could collect all the damage mechanism activated in the blocks on a map because we did systematic observation and identification of different damage mechanisms. But above all, we could deepen the analysis, selecting a block in order to give to the municipalities this first tool on which think about to have the first decision on. So we identify some important step. First of all, the reconstruction of evolutionary process of the block, because we saw that all the added part in a block was possible place for a damage. So we could pass to the interpretation of the weakness and the strengthened point in the pre-earthquake condition. So we tried to give to the local techniques some idea, some method with which proceed to analyze the condition of damage that the block presented. So this first, I want to underline that this work was made with the help of very young people, PhD student or young degree student. And so we were learning together how to do, because we never had experience on this situation of post-earthquake emergency phase. Just for this experiment carried out in Casentino, we could pass to study another center that was much more damaged, and this is Villa Sant'Angelo, and there we saw a much compromised situation. As you can see from this picture, it seems no earthquake damage, but like a bombing, and it was very, very difficult to work there. This was the settlement where the major number of people died. 37 people died in this little settlement. The difficult was not only technical but psychological, because the people, because we were called to speak with the people, and they didn't want to speak about to reconstruct the houses, because they have fear. So we decided first of all to convince ourselves on the possibility to reconstruct, because if not, we couldn't explain to the people about this possibility. So for this purpose, we selected a block, a very compromised block, to try if it was possible to understand the reason of this very heavy collapse. So we worked on this purpose, and of course the only tool we had were observation, systematic observation. And these are some sketch we did on the field. The idea was to observe very carefully the position of the debris in order to discover the beginning of the movement that provoked the collapse of the portion of the block. And doing this work, we recognize, for example, a lot of things, but the most important is that the part much more collapsed was covered with a new roof in concrete slab, very stiff and heavy. And so little by little we understood that every collapse had a reason under it. So it was very, very, very hard work, but rationally we convinced ourselves that some proposal to reconstruct was possible. Coming very in the future in Amatrice, I want to underline you that the problem of the transformation of elements of the building, of the masonry, of the historical masonry building, without paying attention to its characteristic, it's when the earthquake arrive, became tragical. This picture is very, very clear about this. In Amatrice, the most of the collapse were due to heavy slabs put on very weak masonry structure. As you can see in this terrible photograph because here people died. It could be a very long speech to speak about the reason of this practice in Italy that was in something in past time also suggested by the law. But now we understood this this situation, and now in Italy we are very convinced that it's very important to intervene on masonry structure with carefully. In fact, in this picture, you can see the main street of Amatrice. The same, you can see the same bell tower, and in this part the house are standing after the earthquake, the first main shock, and you can see this chain on the facade, and look, you can see that the facade moved during the earthquake, but at the end of the shock, it's coming back in a new equilibrium. So it's very important to, in our opinion, to intervene with the proper techniques on masonry building. Coming back to our blocks, so we finished this sample analysis and started in another question, because after the another meeting with the population, the mayor asked us to think about the issue of debris removal in order to clear the street and allow the following analysis and intervention on the other blocks. So we started to think about this rubble and removal plan and public street securing. Also, this program, this plan, was a completely new for us, but also for the situation of all the other settlements in the area. If you see this picture, you can understand the situation that we could face. A lot of streets were interrupted by the rubble, and the other thing was that we couldn't know the previous situation of the building, their height and consistency. So it was difficult how to decide how to collect the data, how to represent in a map the situation, the actual condition. Also in this case, we could think about identification of a procedure for assessing quantity of debris and remaining standing wall. So we don't know how the house were before, how high the house were before the earthquake. So we decided to map the remaining wall. Could you imagine the difficulty to work in this area? But little by little, and with a lot of careful, we succeed to survey the situation. The basic criteria of the rubble removal plan are defining the operation that are strictly necessary to restore the viability of street and public open space, making only the essential removal. The second one is selecting during the execution of intervention stone materials for their possible reuse. The plan was drawn in three steps. The first step was the actual condition map, of course. You can see here the location and height of the debris and remaining wall and map of collapse state, of course. The second step put forward the basic criterion of the project, working on roads as unit, we could have a map of intervention areas. This point, this triangle, means the point in from which the car could enter to move the debris moving from the interrupted areas. Also, we try to deepen a part of this project in order to make it possible to realize the construction site. And so in this way, we gave to the municipality this operational tool. Working, the time was passing, of course, and in 2011, the Italian law introduced the reconstruction plan. That the reconstruction plan were used after the Second World War in Italy to reconstruct the city and the little villages. And after L'Aquila, this idea of plan just dedicated to the reconstruction after the earthquake was put forward. The law permitted to the local administration the possibility to choose their own consultant. For this reason, the Villa Sant'Angelo Major asked us, because we were working there from 2009, to as a consultant for Villa Sant'Angelo for the elaboration of the post-seismic reconstruction plan. In this way, we remain there, and we started this work that was very difficult, very long and very complicated, because the procedure, the administrative procedure, was not so clear, and was the first time that in Italy we had this kind of plan. This was the condition of Villa Sant'Angelo and Tussillo, that is a part in this on the slope of the hill. And in the middle, you can see here the temporary village that was built 6 months after the earthquake for the people that lost their houses. So the law described very precisely every step of the post-seismic reconstruction plan, and putting in clear the purposes of this instrument, that were defining strategic guidelines in order to ensure a socio-economic recovery, promoting town rehabilitation in relation to density, quality, and complementary of local public services on a urban scale, as well to a more general environmental quality, facilitating the displaced inhabitants return to their home. Also, this work was started. First of all, we moved and we lived there in the month of the elaboration of the plan, because the work was open to the people. The people could come in the office, in the technical office, to discuss and to ask about what we were doing and we were thinking about. And so it was very, very interesting from this point of view. But the plan was divided in these three phases. First of all, the cognitive framework, in which we collected all the data on the block and the unit, and the construction techniques and the damage. And this was not the same work that we did for in the previous job, but we had to follow the indication of the law, of course. After that, we started with the plan choice, deciding intervention categories, and also to selection the some parts of the settlement that we consider very important for the restarting of the life in it. Also, we added to this plan the guidelines for building intervention and also the guidelines for architectural intervention on the street facade. This because we were aware that at the end of the reconstruction process, what you will see is what you can see from the outside. That is not an obvious thing to think. I want just to show you very simply some documents that we were called to draw. For example, one of the problems was to understand what about the soil, and so we should compare the micro zone to the damage that affected the settlement. And for sure, fortunately, we were not in a soil that amplified the damage. We worked on the knowledge of the masonry structure and the masonry work, because also in this case we know very well the importance of the quality of the wall for the entire building. And so on. So a big work of observation and collection, also because I didn't tell you, but this reconstruction plan was linked to the funding of money for the reconstruction that were given from the state to the municipality. So there were a lot of problem in counting how many money the municipality could have from the state. It was very, very difficult and very very tiring to discuss about all these things, above all about the funding issue. This, for example, you can see here all the limitation of block and the subdivision of the bigger block in different part, and every block have inside the units, because also this was an administrative necessity, because the money we should has given to the block and not to the to the owners. So there were a lot of things that went away from the technical or the capacity of an architect or an engineer. Coming to the part most interesting for me is that we just because there were a lot of collapses, so we decided to try to not to demolish other things. So we checked very carefully what was not possible to maintain, but putting in evidence what it was standing and it was possible to solve. So we worked on two scale, the scale of a urbanistic plan, but also contemporary in a scale of of the architecture. In this way, we try to convince the people and also the municipality to follow a line of preservation on what was not collapsed, because in many cases the people would cut everything, and so we discussed it and we succeed to convince people to maintain the alignment of the street, and also to not demolish all the things, but to comply on the collapsed portion, for example. It was a big discussion and a big and a very long work to do. At the end, this plan had a very big part of collected in a database, because the database was used during the implementation of the plan to manage all the situation of the building, the units, and the block. This is one of the table of the counting of the money that we'll need for the realization of the reconstruction. So we had a lot of very big Excel files that represent the economic part of the reconstruction plan. The second one I want to show you, it's very close to Villa Sant'Angelo, but very different. The distance between the two settlements is less than 10 kilometers, but here the damage was much more contained. Also the center, the settlement is very different, is not a circular one, but it's as you can see a line under this mountain, but and also in this case we proceeded with the construction plan. Here, if the houses were not so damaged, there were landslides that started from the mountain and arrived in the urban fabric. So the same tools, the reconstruction plan, but in completely different situation. But simpler, because we didn't have any problem with the collapses and debris. And so in this way we could work in different way, looking much more to the architecture and understanding how the houses are built, and also working on the damage situation much more clearly. These are some of the drawings that are part of the construction plan that show the section of the settlement. You can see that the houses are close to the slope, and the slope is different high, and also you can see this little cave that are in the rear part of the building. In any case, like these, there are different cases. These are collapsed during the earthquake because the very thin spessore, mia la parola, of the street. So as I said, the analysis went on studying a lot of buildings, and both from the architectural point of view and also proceeding with this abacus that give us the possibility to understand the different situation of the houses linked to the constructional techniques elements. And then also we recognize some transformation that occurred in the time on the urban fabric. In this way we recognize some weakness of the urban fabric, and we put in evidence what kind of disassembly could be suggested to improve the safety of the roads. Also here we could study in deep the architectural feature as you can see here, but also the constructional situation, the quality of the wall, of course, that is the important part, of course, for the stability. And so we we could understand all the parts and of the houses in order to suggest how to intervene for the restoration project. Also, of course, we checked in a lot of cases, specific houses, the crack partners, and also in the facade. So doing here a work much more important and much more efficient than in Villa Sant'Angelo that was too much compromised. Here, for example, there is the map, the synthetic map of damage mechanism, and here the indication of reconstruction plan. I didn't show you, but also a castle was in this settlement. It was abandoned during at the time of the earthquake, but we decided to use this because it was public property to propose to start from here the reconstruction in order to give a symbolic idea for the new life of this settlement. Here we you can see the proposal of intervention for the intervention on the houses. Here we could suggest what is possible to transform and what is not, in order to give to the architect, the engineers that could elaborate the single project, an idea of what these houses can support as a transformation and what is not possible to transform. Another and last part of the plan was dedicated just to this important part, the castle, the church, and the piazza. And on this part was dedicated a special attention in order to propose some not mandatory, of course. This was not inside the reconstruction plan, but was some addition to the plan that could be used by the municipality to think about. And in this case, for example, some proposal for the castle I told you before. And also we tried to work on a pilot project for the block, also in this case in order to try to face the problem that could emerge from this reconstruction plan. At the end, also in this case, we tried to give also some indication for in this case for the color from the finiture of the facade in order to complete and to imagine the reconstruction of this settlement finished. I think I can stop here and thank you very much.
We We thank you very much to Professor Carozzi. Now, let's see if there are any questions from the audience.
Stop.
Yes.
Yes, I'd like to say something.
Yes, Melissa?
Yeah. Hello, Professor. Very interesting project and very big one. I think that it was very important to have the financial support from the state.
Yes.
I think this is very a great motive for the owners, because here in Greece the financial support is the big problem. We have so many settlements abounded, and we don't have the support to make a project like this, and in this way we lost our historical settlements, and this is a disappointed here issue for us in our country. I mean, so I think that to have a financial support from the authorities is a very important to make projects like this. And I want to ask for these settlements. All these settlements had a specific framework. I mean, as had a specific legislative framework.
Every settlement had to have a reconstruction plan. Without the reconstruction plan, the state did not give the money. Because they wanted very much that the idea was that you cannot build out of the settlement, not to destroy the surroundings. Because in other earthquake in the past, this was terrible, because people lost the houses, the old houses, and they built another houses in the country, not far, but not in the settlement. So all the territory was full of new houses. Oh. And this is the sense of the law. But of course, you are right. But in Italy, every earthquake, after every earthquake, the government, the state, give money to the people who had damages in the houses. Other problem is the question of the abandoned villages. We have a lot, because people move, like in Greece, of course, people move from the village to the town, and we have a very big built heritage almost abandoned. And in last years, some law started to work on this, because not only for preservation reason, but also because there are a lot of problems with these abandoned built areas, of course. And so there are a lot of researches and a lot of money on research on this issue in Italy.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much.
To continue, Melissa's... yes? Did you finish, Melissa?
Of course, the money are necessary, but are also a big problem, because when there are money, it's difficult to discuss with people, of course. So every technicians wants to have money, because also when it was not right to do this. So it's a very difficult field to move in post earthquake situation.
Well, to continue what Melissa asked, I was wondering about the sum of the money. Was it covering the total of the spaces, or was it a part of? So that the owners should also give a part of the spaces by themselves. What exactly happened?
In Italy, in L'Aquila.
In this case, in Aquila, yes.
No, they had money. The state fixed a level of funding for 2 square meter, and the people had could have this amount of money, of course, with projects connected to the other owners, and they had to form an association of the block, and a technician had to elaborate the project for the block. So very, very complicated issue, and also started a big amount of work for architects and engineers, because a lot of people was involved in this big office that has to check the project. So it was an incredible phases of the reconstruction plan. Also because the check were specific on the money issue, of course, of the project, not only on the technical part of the project, but also with money, of course, because it were public money.
It seems it operating well. The results seem to be okay.
We are not at the end, of course, because the money arrive not very slow.
Not
so
very normally.
Yes, and also in L'Aquila was not a very very lively area, so there were not so too much technicians. So I saw, when I was there, I saw young engineers that had 300 projects, impossible things, because a lot of work in the same time, and a lot of problem arise from this earthquake. But and then there were two lines of funding, one for residential and private buildings, and the other for public, and another one for the church. The church were a specific funds part, and so also the reconstruction was divided in these three lines, let's say. But now, if you go to L'Aquila, it's not, of course, it's not finished, but a lot of things were restored, were reopened.
It's a little difficult for me to see who is who wants to ask questions, because you have not stopped entirely your share screen, Caterina. We can still.
Okay.
Yes.
Scusa. Così. No. It's better. No, ecco.
Okay. So, now.
Sorry.
Are there any other questions?
May I ask you something?
Έχω το λόγο.
Ναι, βεβαίως.
Thank you very much, Professor Garoch, for your presentation. I would like to put some questions concerning the civil engineering point of view. First of all, you mentioned that you did some in-depth analysis. Was it structural analysis? Or
in our group, we were different people, of course, and there were also a group of engineers from the University of Genova, Professor Lago Marzino. I don't know if you.
Yeah, I know.
And we were together in this. I showed also the part of my group, but he followed the part of dedicated to the structural system for the reconstruction, and we discussed a lot about this possibility to not to do to demolish all the remains, and so he had a lot of presentation to the to the population, to the inhabitants, because this was the very core of the problem, of course, the safety of the reconstruction.
Okay. May I continue?
Yes,
yeah. Yeah, okay. Professor Lago Marciano is a very experienced and very well-known engineer. I would also like to ask you if you followed some codes, structural codes, such as Italian code or Euro codes, did you have design earthquakes against for the design of the interventions?
Yeah. After an earthquake that was in 2003, the seismic code in Italy was completely renewed, and.
Yes, and Professor Lago Marciano was
yes,
the leader.
Yes. And this code was improved next year. It was a version of 2008, and the last one is 2018. So in this code, the cinematic yes. Mechanism are included, and so this part dedicated to the masonry structure is, you know, in Italy there are a lot of very good engineers that work for many years in this field.
I know it. And Can you give us an idea about the severity of the interventions, such as were they mainly repair or strengthening? What was the target?
Allora, the target was clearly assessed from the law, because we could improve the 60% at least the 60%. This was the indication, the prescription of the law. In the case of Villa Sant'Angelo, of course, we had to reconstruct a lot, but the reconstruction had the problem not to to destroy what was standing. I have to say that also during the implementation, the construction site, a lot of changement were made because, of course, one thing is a plan, and another thing is to sign a project, of course. Mm-hmm. So I can't say exactly the level of changement, but I'm sure that the plan was not so simple to be followed by the technician.
But yes, and finally another question: could you please describe the materials of intervention? And the techniques, yeah, yes, and the techniques.
No, because we in the reconstruction plan we just put propose this pilot project, and in this project we tried to suggest working with the not traditional, but with the logic of traditional method of structure. This is possible only in some cases, of course, not in all cases. For example, in Palazzo Ardinghelli, I show at the beginning of the presentation, we worked with Sergio and Serena Cattari from Genova, and we designed exactly in the way of a traditional construction site, using tie rods, metallic tie rods, to reinforce the masonry, and reconstruction with the reconstruction of portion of wall that were collapsed in the palace. And also the covering was made by wooden. So generally, because Lago Marzino is very, very convinced that not that the concrete is bad, but that it can be used in proper mode to work with the masonry structure. And I agree with him, because I saw a lot of damages, very, very important and very terrific, when the concrete was put on masonry that are very fragile. And this is the problem. The main problem is this. But this was because in the past the technician were not aware. It was a matter of culture, of course. Not this is the now for our period. It's completely different, I think.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you to you.
Maybe that's why the state says after your project to the owners that they can have their own consultants. No.
No. Sorry,
You said that after the project, the state says that to the owners that now you can have your own consultants. To maintain their buildings. No, maybe I didn't understand, because Mr. Stylianides asked you about the techniques, and I think that if the owners have the opportunity to choose their own consultant after that, the techniques are it's not only one technique. I mean,
yes, I understand now. Allora, they were obliged to have an architect or an engineer. Every blocks that every block. Was an association of owners should have a technicians. And this technician has to following the reconstruction plan within the reconstruction plan could elaborate the executive project, let's say, okay? And of course, in this case, because every technician has to sign the project, the technician has the responsibility of the project, of course. So, of course, every one of them could choose the techniques to use. But we had a lot of meeting with them to explain the, let's say, the choice of the plan. Then, of course, we we don't know. I don't know exactly. I didn't follow every project, of course. But in sometimes I was informed about them. So, okay. I don't know.
So you mean that in the case of simple houses, let's say, there was a little bit of freedom in the way the project was executed? Is that what you mean?
Yes. Because it's normal, I think, and. I don't know the final result, but I think that this the choice to have the reconstruction plan it was good both for financial items, but also because every municipality has an own rules. Specific rules for his communities. I think this was a good idea.
Hello, thank you for your presentation. I was actually wondering, you've said, if I got it right, that it's not really finished yet, is it?
No, it's not. It's not.
And I was wondering what the timeline was, because the earthquake was in 2009, and I don't know when you started with this whole survey project, and then when it actually started to be taking place in reality, and then when is it supposed to finish?
Allora,
We finished the reconstruction plan in 2015, so 6 years later. Then it happens that my previous students was involved from the, you know, the big office of the reconstruction to stay there, to work there. So I follow the phases from 2015, from 2020, because she told me, I asked her, oh, what's the matter? She was in the office for the checking of the project. So I asked sometimes, what's about Villa Sant'Angelo? What's about Fossa? And in 5 years, they made the project for 2 or 3 blocks. So very, very slowly.
How many were they in total? Because I think I got lost in the numbers and everything.
What?
How many blocks was it altogether?
In Villa Sant'Angelo, like 30, for example. And also for Fossa, the problem was that before the starting of the sites, there were the problem of the landslides, and they had to fix the mountain before start the reconstruction. And this was a problem because this was in another ministry and other funding, and very, very complicated. So, and there is another thing I have to say to you, that people, for example, Fossa, Fossa is very beautiful. There is this mountain and there is this settlement put under the mountain, okay? But all this north, so all the houses were put on north, while the new settlement, the temporary houses that they built after the earthquake, they built on south. So people now like very much to be
temporary
in the temporary houses. Last 2 years for coronavirus, no, but I generally used in summer to go in 15 August in Fossa, because there is a big, festa where you can eat local foods, and they stay in this temporary village very, very, they like very much, because it's completely different, and I don't know if they come back in the future to the old house. I don't know.
Thank you very much for your answer.
Thank you to you.
Any other questions, please?
Bene.
Let me see the second page. Yeah. Anyway, because in Thessaloniki we also had damages with the great earthquake of
1798.
That it was so late, so slow, the process in Italy, because here also. If I think about Rotonda, for example, it took half a century to finish with Rotonda. So I think it's okay.
No, ma, it's now I, while preparing the presentation, I saw that I'm almost 30 years that I work on earthquake. And when I was in in 1997 in Umbria Marche earthquake, I just finished the PhD, but if you go there now, there are churches in the same condition. Not all the things are. And also, if you go to Messina, where there was in 1908 earthquake, the biggest earthquake that Italy had, you can see also the temporary houses still used. So it's clear that the timing is not possible.
What kind of temporary houses is that?
In L'Aquila. In Villa Sant'Angelo, this is also another question, because every municipality had, a twin in Italy. For example, Villa Sant'Angelo was Trento. The Trento municipalities give the temporary houses to Villa Sant'Angelo. So that kind of temporary houses are with the like mountain houses. While
it came from the north.
Yes, in Fossa they are completely different. I don't know which kind of phones were used there. So, but yes, are very comfortable. I was living there in Villa Sant'Angelo for almost 1 year in one of these houses, and it was perfect.
I think that the what really matters is to have the time to finish all this reconstruction before the next earthquake.
Ah, no. We had other. It's impossible. No, the pity is that every earthquake in Italy arrive, and it seems that is the first one, because a lot of things depends from the politics, of course, and so this L'Aquila earthquake arrived while Berlusconi was going down. Mm-hmm. And with this earthquake, he had the opportunity to so it's very it's depending from a lot of things.
Any other questions, please? So, I think that we have finished for today.
Grazie.
I cannot see any other hands raised. So, thank you very much, Caterina.
Grazie a voi e scusate per il mio inglese veramente pessimo.
Oh, no, it's okay. We are all people of Mediterranean, so
yes.
Our inglese is always like Mediterranean mode. So, a domani.
A domani, grazie a tutti e buona serata.
Thank
arrivederci.
You.
Arrivederci.